Everybody knows what Hanukkah is? Yes. Hanukkah is now, it's a time of celebration where we celebrate light over darkness, and we also celebrate the rededication, which is the purification of the Jewish temple. This is the second Jewish temple that stood in Jerusalem in Israel 2,500 years ago. It's the second temple. And there was a miracle that happened in that temple. I will tell you all about it. Now, the story of the Jewish people begins much before the temple. Even before the temple, the story of the Jewish people begins with this man. Avraham Avinu, Avraham our father, our forefather, was born 4,000 years ago. Avraham was born 4,000 years ago outside of Israel in a place called Ur Kashdim. Can you say Ur Kashdim? Ur Kashdim. And when he was 75 years old, that's like four times your dad, 75 years old, God came to him and God said, Avraham, I want you to collect all your belongings and all your family, and I want you to go from Ur Kashdim and on a journey start to walk to a place that I will show you. And so Avraham Avinu took all his belongings and all his family, and he started to walk. And God brought him to the state of Israel, to the country of Israel. And God told him, that is the place where you're going to live. And Avraham, he lived in many cities in Israel for many, many years. And he had a son, Yitzchak, and a grandson, which is Yaakov. Avraham, Yitzchak, Yaakov, the three forefathers of the Jewish nation. And they lived in all the cities of Israel. And when he died, Avraham and his wife Sarah died, they were buried in this cave known as Me'arat HaMachpelah. Can you say Machpelah? Machpelah in Israel. Avraham actually bought this land. He paid for that land and he bought it. And he had children and grandchildren and grandchildren, and they became a big nation in Israel consisting of 12 tribes. These are the 12 tribes, 12 Jewish tribes that live in different sections in Israel. And each tribe, your forefathers, each of those tribes, they had a special job. Each tribe had a special job they had to do in Israel. And each one also had a special symbol. So these are the 12 tribes of Israel. And they lived, the 12 Jewish tribes lived like that in Israel for many years, until King David united all the separate tribes into one country. This is the United Kingdom of Israel. That is the first time the Jewish people lived in autonomy, which means they rule the land and they rule the country. That is under the King David. King David is your great-great-great-great-grandfather. And that is the United Kingdom of Israel 3,000 years ago. That's like 3,000 years ago, the Jewish people lived in their own autonomy in Israel under King David. The United Kingdom of Israel. And today we lived in the United Kingdom. God bless these beautiful countries of ours, the United Kingdom. The roots of the Jewish people is also United Kingdom, the United Kingdom of Israel, under King David. This is King David, and you can see that he had red hair. King David was very famous, very known for having red hair, and he liked to play the lute. He was an artist. I'll tell you a secret. King David didn't want to be a king. He wanted to be an artist. He was an artist. He was a very humble man, you see, playing the lute. But he was so good with people and animals that even the animals would bow to him, you see. The animal bowed to King David, and they made King David a king because he was so good. They crowned him. And this mosaic that you see, this artwork that you see here, this actual artwork was made 1,500 years ago after King David, but many years ago. 1,500 years ago, this mosaic was made. And you can see it says here in Hebrew, David. I can read it. Dalet, Vav, Yud, Dalet. David, King David. So even 1,500 years ago, we still use the same Hebrew language that we're using today. Jewish people have a very long history of language and culture. We can read stuff we did many, many years ago. So King David, after he united all the people, he bought this mountain in Jerusalem and said, I'm going to make Jerusalem the capital city of the Jewish people. And he bought the mountain, he paid for it, just like Abraham before him, you know, who paid for the Ma'arat HaMachpelah in Hebron, so did King David pay for this mountain in Jerusalem. And I remember when I was your age, how old are you?
Seven.
And you seven?
10.
10 years old. When I was almost 10, I think I was 8 years old, your age, in schools in Israel, in every class, we had a charity box like this. It's called Keren Kayemet LeYisrael. Keren Kayemet Israel. In every classroom, we have this charity box, and we would put money to buy lands in Israel to build the country. Like King David before us, who paid for Jerusalem, and Abraham before us, we would collect money to build the country. And so King David bought this land, this big mountain in Jerusalem, and he built a city, and his son, Amelech Shlomo, King Solomon, the wisest man of all, his son built the first Jewish temple. First Jewish temple of King Solomon in Jerusalem. See, this is the city of David in Jerusalem. Jerusalem is known as the city of light and gold, because when the sun sets, the beautiful sun in Israel, which is very bright, when it sets down, it casts this gold red light on the beautiful stone, and it looks like gold. Even inside buildings, it looks like gold. That's real. I was there. I took that photo. That's inside the building in Jerusalem, and it looks like gold. It's amazing. So the Jewish people built the second temple in Jerusalem some 2,500 years ago. After the first temple was destroyed, they built the second temple in Jerusalem. The temple is really unique because people would come to visit it three times a year. Three times a year, they would come to Jerusalem. And do you see this light, this fire? This was a fire that was burning like 24/7, all the time. It never stopped. But 24/7, the light, the flame were burning. It's like your Wi-Fi connection. It's always there. And the structure, the shape of the building, the architecture, looked very simple to us. But when they built it, it was very special. The structure is modeled after a lion, shape of the lion. A lion is the shape of the Jewish temple. The Jewish temple is called Bet Hamikdash. Can you say Hamikdash?
Hamikdash.
Yes, that's right. Bet Hamikdash Hasheni, the second. And so, this is the lion. You see the head with the mane, with the hair. So that's the shape. That's the head with the mane, with the hair. And this is the body of the lion right there, and this is the body of the temple. Those gold triangles represent the crown of God. Because the lion is the king of all animals, is that right? Yeah, the lion is the king of all animals. That's the lion. And it's also the symbol of Jerusalem. And the Bet HaMikdash, the temple, is the symbolic house of God. One God for all people. And God is the king of all kings. We have kings? Well, those kings have another king, that is God. So do Jewish people believe. And if you walked up this staircase from here, all the way up those staircase right there, you will reach the big hole. That's the big hole in Jewish temple, Bet HaMikdash. You see, this is the high priest, Kohen Gadol, standing next to a gold menorah. And behind them is this massive curtain, pure silk. I mean, how high do you think that curtain was? Do you know? How much?
10 meters.
Any other guess? How tall, how high was this curtain? 10 meters or maybe even 20 meters tall. 20 meters of pure silk. And it was actually hiding something. The curtain doesn't matter. What matters is what it was hiding behind it. Behind it was a sacred room. It's called Holy of the Holiest, the most sacred room in the Jewish tradition. Like there was nothing more sacred than this. In Hebrew, Kodesh HaKodeshim. Can you say Kodesh HaKodeshim? Yes, that's right. It was there. Behind this was Kodesh HaKodeshim. Now some of you may know if you've been last year, but if not, I'll ask you again. Do you know what was in the most sacred room of the Jewish tradition, the Kodesh HaKodeshim? What was in the room? Torah. Torah, the Jewish book. Yeah? Any other guess? Yeah?
The temple.
Yes. This was actually inside the temple. The temple was bigger and the room was inside the temple. You're right. Part of the temple. Any other guess what was in the most sacred Kodesh HaKodeshim of Jewish nation?
Menorah,
the Jewish menorah was actually outside, right there. So in the most sacred room of Jewish tradition, Kodesh HaKodeshim was nothing. There was nothing there. It was empty. It was just a space. Because the holiest thing in the Jewish belief is not gold, it's not stone, it's not something, it is nothing. Because only God can create something out of nothing. We, human beings, we can create something out of something. I can take wood, which is something I can carve it, make it into sculpture. So I'm creating something, sculpture, out of something, out of wood. But God, so do Jewish people believe, can create something out of nothing. It's like your thought, idea, a concept. In Hebrew, we call it yesh mi'ayin, something that exists out of nothing. Whereas we, human beings, we can create only yesh Miyesh, something out of something. So in the most sacred room, there was actually nothing there. It's the spiritual connection of you. And that is the image of God. When we say the image of God, in Hebrew, Betzalem Elohim, sometimes people think we mean that we look like God physically. No, the image of God means the potential of God to think and to feel. And so you can think and feel. All human beings are born in the image of God. And so the high priest, remember when I told you about the 12 tribes? The 12 tribes, so the high priest had 12 gems, 12 stones here. Each stone represented the tribe, one tribe. Even under King David, when they were all united, we remember the 12 tribes. And Kohen Gadol, he was the only one who can go to the Holy of the Holies, Kodesh HaKodeshim, and only once a year. And he would bless the people and he would bless the food. He would bless people by doing this gesture, like that. Do you know this from Star Trek? It is connection, the Star Trek symbol taken from Judaism. Yeah? So Star Trek symbol was invented by Jewish people. Can you do like that? I don't know if it's effective, because only the high priest who was from a certain tribe, he could actually do the blessing. But we can all do that. Yeah, apart from the Kohanim, yeah, sure. Well, I had to practice to do it. And later on I will give you paper, I will give you that print paper, you can decorate it and you can put rainbow if you want and do whatever, drawing on this later on. So the high priest, he would bless the oil that was used to light the menorah. This is the Jewish menorah. How high was the menorah? Probably 2 meters. 2 meters of pure gold. Every tribe gave a bit of gold to Beit HaMikdash, and from that gold, they made pure menorah. It's pure gold. From gold by the tribe. And the high priest, he would bless the oil and he would seal it with his signature. Only the oil that the high priest would bless, that we could use to light the menorah. The menorah then was based on the shape of a plant that they found in Israel. That's the shape. And it had only 7 branches. Let's count. 7 branches. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's right. So it had only 7 branches. And they would put oil in it and wick, because they didn't have candles in those days. Oil and wick, and they would light it with oil. And so, the menorah is still a symbol today in Israel, obviously. Here's a recent, modern Israeli coin, and you see the menorah here. Still a symbol of Israel. And it says Israel, Israel, Israel. Hebrew, Arabic, and English. That's modern money in Israel. It's a symbol of the menorah. And we have the menorah on chocolate coin, which I have, and I will give you later on. We give children chocolate coin in Hanukkah, so they remember to give to charity. And so, for many years, the Jewish people, they lived like that, with no problem, in the temple, and they were happy, and they can practice their religion in Jerusalem, in their capital. until the Roman Empire broke up, the big empire called Roman Empire, they broke up to separate armies. And one army was this, with the naughty king Antiochus. Antiochus was a naughty king of the Assyrian army. Assyrian was just outside Israel. He was really naughty. He didn't let people practice their religion. It was the first time that any empire didn't allow people to practice their religion. It was religion persecution at that time. He wanted everyone to do what he wants. So he sent his troop to Jerusalem. They went into a temple and they destroyed all the oil and they made massive mess inside our temple, destroyed all the oil, and they put this stone. This is a sculpture of Antiochus in Jerusalem. And they said to all the Jewish people, you now have to pray to us, to Antiochus. Can you imagine that? Jewish people don't pray to stones. We don't pray to statues, to stones. Remember I told you the Holy of Holies, Kodesh HaKodeshim was nothing? Nothing is the real power of God. Not a stone, not an image, not a sculpture. So the Jewish people, they refuse to pray, thank you. The Jewish people, they refuse to pray to that stone. And he told them, you have to pray to that stone, and you cannot learn Torah, our book, anymore. So they refused. They escaped to the mountains, and they would learn Torah in the mountains, hiding. Jerusalem, there are many mountains. And when they saw soldiers coming to them and trying to check that they are, don't study Torah, they would hide the Torah book, and they would pretend that they would play the Svivon. This is Svivon. They would take it out, and they would pretend to play Svivonim. Spinning toy, Svivon. When the soldier went away, they would put the spinning toy back, they would take out the Torah book, and they would study the Torah. So later on, I will give you Svivon. I have Svivonim here. And you can decorate them. Later on, we'll do it. You can take it home, it's for you. And we also write the letter on Svivon. I will explain it later on. For a few years, we lived like that, hiding in the mountain, until this guy, Yehuda HaMakabi, and his friend, Yehudit HaMakabit, the Jewish guy, they rose to power and they said, we're not going to have any more of this, we're going to fight back. This was the first fight where a nation is known to fight for its religious independence. It's the first fight where people fought to have religious independence. And they are called Makabim. Makabim in Hebrew. Mi kamocha ba'elim Adonai. Acronym Maccabim. And they say, we're going to fight back against this evil Antiochus and his evil army. But how would they win? There were not many Jews around, so the Maccabim, they gather a few thousands of warriors. But how can they win against this mighty, mighty army? They had machines, they had tens of thousands. How would they win a small Jewish army of only thousands of people? So they went to big priest, Kohen Gadol. They went to the Kohen Gadol and asked him, what shall we do? The Kohen Gadol told them, I know you only have a few thousands of soldiers, and I know the wicked Antiochus army is massive, I know that, but I want you to trust God. Trust God and something will happen. So they said, okay, and the next day they went to the war, they hid in the mountains, and when they saw the wicked army of Antiochus, they say, what can we do? But they really believed, and then a miracle happened. God gave them special weapons. First, God gave them a Maccabim light zappers. Now I have Maccabim light zappers here. Each child is going to have a Maccabim light zapper, and you can take it home with you. I'll show you. See that? See? This is Maccabim light zappers, yeah? Each child will get one, you can take it home. So, God gave them Maccabim light zapper, and when they saw the wicked army, they jumped to them, and they zapped them with light, like this. And they went like that, and they zapped them all around with light. Maccabim, like that. And the Assyrian soldier, they couldn't comprehend, it was too much for them. And they started to escape. We have a song about light zappers. Kolbanu choshech legaresh. We sing the song and we go around the room, and every place you see darkness, you will zap it with your zap light. Okay? And the other thing that God did was to give the Jewish people the super bracelet. You see? Super Jewish bracelet. So when they had the bracelet and they saw the wicked soldier, they would jump with the bracelet all around the mountain next to the soldier like that, and they would zap them, and then they could zap themselves out, they could escape. I have the super power bracelet here with me, but I need your help. You will decorate it, okay? Each child could take it home, but you will decorate it with some pens that I brought, okay? We will do it very soon. I know it's a long presentation. We will do it very soon, don't worry. And God gave them another thing. He gave them those special shields made with the stone of the 12 tribes with gems. These shields don't just protect you, but they would also break the light, and they would dazzle the light all into the Assyrian army. So I have some gemstones here, see, which I will give you later, with this template, and you can create your own gemstone shield. Okay, so with these magical tools, the Jewish people, although they were so small, they managed to chase away the wicked Assyrian army and save Jerusalem. And after they drove the wicked army away, they went back to Beth HaMikdash. And Beth HaMikdash, it was a bit ruined, you know, the Assyrian destroyed. So they cleaned it up, they put the menorah back, but then there was not enough oil, because the Assyrian, they desecrated all the oil, they broke it. But there was a young child, think your age, who crawled, and this child found one jar of oil. Only one jar of oil, one bottle of oil. One bottle wouldn't be enough, it would last for only one night. So they lit up the menorah, but they say that would not last, it would last for only one evening. They cleaned the temple, Beit HaMikdash, and they said, never mind, it would last only for one evening, but what can we do? So they went home, they came back the next day, and the light still stood. The fire was still consuming. Now that's strange. It's one jar of oil, one bottle of oil, should last for one night, and it lasts for a full day, the next day. Okay, so they clean up the temple more, and they went home in the evening. They say, well, it will not last for long anymore. Never mind, what can we do? They went the second day, and the light still stood. Two nights, the light stood. And then three, four, five, eight nights. For eight nights, this little jar of oil was able to hold the light. Instead of one day, it was holding for 8 days. And that was the second miracle of Hanukkah, second miracle. And for that reason, we celebrate Hanukkah for 8 days today. Eight is the symbol of infinity. See, that's the shape of eight, that means infinity. And because it was a miracle of 8 days, you remember the seven branches? Yes, like that, eight. Well, it could be like that, or on the side like that. And because it was the miracle of 8 days, we now celebrate 8 days of Hanukkah, and we have eight branches, not seven, eight.
One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight.
So it's eight branches plus this, which is the ninth. This is called shamash, the service. You would use that to light the others. So it's eight branches, nine with the shamash, eight because of the miracle of 8 days. The first menorah was seven branches, and now it is eight. By removing the wicked army, the Maccabim enabled to establish the second Jewish independent state in Israel, Mamlechet HaChoshmonaim, a few years later. The second Jewish independent state of Israel, where Jewish live independently in Israel. Today we have the third Jewish independent state in Israel. And so, because it was a miracle of oil, the oil lasts for 8 days. We eat food which is baked in oil, like donuts, sufganiyot. We have some donuts, sufganiyot, made in oil. Also potato latkes. And we give children chocolate coin to remind them of the miracle and of charity. We play the svivon. Today, on the svivon, the spinning top, we write letters in Hebrew. See? Letters. Nun gimel hei shin. Nes gadol haya sham. A big miracle happened there. There in Israel. Shin, sham, there. If you live in Israel, you would say big miracle happened here, not there. So instead of shin, you will say hey. Hey means poor. Here. Big miracle happened here. When we light the menorah, the candles, we say a blessing. We thank God for the miracle, Al Hanisin, and we thank God for the niflaot, the wonders. What is the difference between miracle and wonders? So miracles are the function of nature, what nature does. Have you noticed that every year winters comes on the right time? Every year you have winters on the right time. Winter never fails to come when it needs to come. That's a miracle. Wonder is our ability to appreciate the miracles. I'll tell you a secret. Some people don't appreciate the rain. They don't appreciate the miracles of nature. We appreciate. We thank God for the miracle He did and for the wonders that He did for our forefathers at this time of the month, some 2,500 years ago. Many years after the temple was cleaned and stood, it was actually destroyed. The second temple was destroyed. The only thing that is left today are some bits of the wall here. You see from this column to this? That's the only thing that is left in Jerusalem here. If you stand here today in Jerusalem, here's a real photo, you would see the only wall that was left. And we pray that the third temple will be built very quickly in our times. Later on, we will build the third temple. We've got some cards here. We brought those cards that we can build. Now, do you want to do art?
Yes.
You've been so good. So let's do art.
Thank you.
Let's start.